Okay, I got my lucky Superbowl hoodie, and we're gonna run the flea flicker, okay? Are you ready?
Yeah.
Break! John, 316! John, 316!
Wait. That's not a normal snap count.
Oh, yeah, well, it's Super Bowl Sunday, and I feel like since Super Bowl is on a Sunday, they should use scripture numbers for the snap count. That's all I'm saying.
What is this John 3:16?
Oh, John 3:16 is one of the most quoted scripture in the Bible, and it says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believes in him shall have eternal life." And it's just such an inspirational scripture.
I mean, all you got to do is believe in him?
Well, yeah, essentially, yes. But you also need to delve into the scripture and read about what Jesus taught and what he was all about, which was love and mercy. And
so does that mean we can't tackle in football?
Well, no, that's not what it means. I mean, you can still tackle in football. It's just a game. What it really comes down to is loving God with all your heart and loving your neighbor as yourself.
So that means it's okay to tackle in football?
Well, yeah, it's okay to tackle in football. It's just a game.
All right.
Maybe not. I landed on my keys. Hey everybody, I just wanted to welcome you to service and I hope you have a wonderful weekend. Today we're talking a little bit about not putting our faith too much in things of the physical world, but rather of things in the spirit. So I hope you have a wonderful Super Bowl weekend and watch out for those tackles. Well, good morning, everybody. Good morning to you all. Welcome to our service this morning. And I am so incredibly thankful that you have decided to join us today, wherever you may be in the world. I pray that everything's going fine for you. I pray your Sunday is off to a good start, or whenever you're watching this. I pray the weather is going well for you. And if it's not, well, I pray that you can find a blessing in it somehow. Well, grace and peace be unto you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who we've come to worship and praise and come together and pray together, and we'll read some scripture together and just have a wonderful service. And so again, thankful you're here. So welcome, everybody. It is warm out here in Southeast Michigan. I don't know what the weather's like where you might be. It's normally really cold in the winter, you know, we're just not even halfway through February, and it's pretty warm out. So it's a nice reminder that despite the cold times in our year or in our lives, the Lord does renew us. The Lord sends us reminders all the time, and this is Easter coming up. It's a time of renewal, and it's just a wonderful blessing to remember that it's hard to sometimes, but you know, we just hold on and we be still and allow God to work on our lives and Christ go before us. But anyway, I'm jumping ahead to the message. Anyway, here we go. Well, welcome again, everybody, and let's go to our centering words. When we look to change others, we will be disappointed. We certainly can't change God, but we can change ourselves. Yet, that's an illusion too. Only God can change us, and that is when we allow Jesus to work in our lives. As the Apostle Paul suggests, we die daily to ourselves. Amen to that. Well, will you join me in our call to worship this morning? I'll have it up here on the screen for you, and we can say it together. The Lord has called you here this day. Lord, reveal to us your purposes for us. Open your hearts to receive God's good news. Lord, make us ready to serve you. Come, let us worship God. Let us sing our praises to the Almighty One. Amen. Amen. Will you pray with me? Let's say a prayer together, and I'll have it up here so we can speak the words together in prayer. Join me, please. Loving God, we gather here today under your care and protection. Thank you for your loving kindness that never fails us. We thank you for those with us that you would guide our thoughts, our actions, to bring you glory. Strengthen us and fill us with your peace. May we love and serve each other as Jesus has shown us and loved us. Fill us with your Holy Spirit to do your good work on earth. It is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. You know, I was thinking, I saved lighting the candle because I got this really cool, we've been had an avalanche of blessings poured upon us with different gifts like this cool lighter. So somebody saw that I was struggling with lighting. Okay, here I'm still struggling a little bit lighting the candle, but there it is. So thank you for that. And this is epic. I got to share this with you out there. I don't know if you've ever seen one of these. Whoops. There it is. I don't know if you can see this or not, but it like, that's a lighter. Pretty awesome. Anyway, that's so great. But thank you out there for those who was very thoughtful of seeing something in need of the service and you provided it, as well as providing a microphone. Oh, I don't know if you can see it. It's like right here. Different recording devices and equipment was given to us. And I just have to say really quick, thank you. Thank you so much for just being a blessing to the services and our churches. And just thank you again for those out there who are so giving and kind in that way. But anyway, I don't know if I mentioned it. My name is Pastor Brian, and I'm leading us in service today, in case you didn't guess that. But again, I welcome you. Let's go on with our service here, and we'll go to our first scripture reading. Oh, no. You know what we should do? We should sing. That's what we should do. Let's sing a song out. We're going to sing Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee. If you're reading a hymnal, it's number 89. Let's sing out together. Great job singing, everybody. And I just love that opening. that opening. Whether you, depending on either way how you feel about, if you remember the Power Hour with Robert Schuller and the Crystal Cathedral, we went there once, or I've been there twice, but the way they open the services with this hymn. And they open up the big doors of the church and these fountains shoot up and it's singing the choir and the huge organ. And it's just this big, beautiful performance and everybody singing joyful, joyful we adore. Anyway, it was awesome. I think about that every time with that song. So anyway, let's go on with now we'll get into our scripture reading and I'll have it up here on the screen so we can read it together. And it is Revelation 21, verses 1 through 7. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death, or mourning, or crying, or pain, for the old order of things has passed away." He who was seated on the throne said, "I am making everything new." Then he said, "Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true." He said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty, I will give water without cost from the spring of the water of life. Those who are victorious will inherit all this, and I will be their God, and they will be my children." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. Amen. Well, my dear friends, I was thinking about this story. There was a pastor who was giving the service one Sunday, and he asked the congregation if they would put a little bit more in the offering plate this week, just a little bit more. And as an added bonus, he said, whoever gives the most, they get to pick out three hymns. And after the offering was brought forward, the pastor noticed that there was a $1,000 bill in there. Well, he got all excited and he said, "Wow, somebody was really generous today. Hey, can I ask, I don't want to call anybody out, but who was it that gave this awesome gift? Surely they're the winner of this contest." And he looked out into the congregation and he saw that a timid, saintly, elderly widow slowly raised her hand. And the pastor said, "That's amazing. Will you come forward? And I want to thank you personally. Do you mind that?" So she did. She came forward and he shook her hand warmly and said, "Well, you get to pick out three hymns today." And so the woman looked out at the congregation and pointed and she said, "I'll take him, him, and him." Yeah. So that didn't have really anything to do with the message today. I just read that earlier this week and I thought it was really cute. So I thought I'd share. Well, anyway, I was watching YouTube videos with our son Johnny the other day, and you can go through them so quick. There's so many of them, but you kind of get caught up on it. It's sort of like perpetual motion. But one of the videos was about a so-called perpetual motion machine. And perpetual motion, of course, is when something can go and go without ever stopping, goes eternally. So what in this setup in this video, it shows where you have a shiny metal marble that goes down a funnel, drops from the bottom of the funnel, rolls down these metal wires and loops up and it shoots the marble back up into the funnel and it goes down again. And it keeps looping around and around. And, I was thinking it's a great symbol of how sometimes we get so caught in a rut with our lives and our jobs and just you know, anyway, it's just around and around, but anyway, just... So this video is really about debunking this device, because it seems like a perpetual motion machine, but in the video it shows that there's a battery-operated mechanism hidden inside the base of it, and that propels the marble forward, giving it an extra boost so that it'll have enough speed to shoot back up into the funnel. And so it was pretty cool, actually, despite the video trying to debunk this thing. I kind of want one. But the announcer doing the video said, well, you can see here the hidden works of this, and once again, proving there is no such thing as perpetual motion. And I thought about that. And I realized, you know, that's not true, if you really think about it. Aren't we kind of like perpetual motion machines? Our lives, I mean, okay, we're not machines. Unless you grew up watching Schoolhouse Rock, you know, that one about nutrition. I'm a machine, you're a machine. Everybody that you know, they are machines. Anyway, but our existences are perpetual. Did you ever stop to consider this thought at all? That we are eternal? It's a little overwhelming, you know, if you think about it too much, but we are created by an eternal God, and we are promised that if we can live in heaven, we can live in heaven with the Lord, and we can do so forever, or in hell for eternal damnation. But, you know, we do need to acknowledge that too, but hopefully not. But either way, we are eternal beings. Isn't that mind-blowing? And the reason why we have eternal life is because God so loved the world that he gave us his only begotten son, Jesus. As a human race, we were going down a one-way road without an exit sign, without anything to stop us. Yet God loved us so much and still loves us. He sent us his son who lived and died. And spoiler alert, because Easter's coming, after 3 days in the tomb, rose back up to life and saved us. When Jesus rose again, he proved that death has no power over him, nor over us. You know, somebody might ask, well, what do you mean death has no power over us? You know, people die every day. Well, you know, first of all, there is only one true power, and that's God. And God is not dead. God could never die. To assume God could die suggests that there is life beyond God. But no, God is life itself, the source of life. And it's through our Lord Jesus Christ that we can experience that life. Not just by repeating words or, you know, by saying certain incantations that say, like, I accept Jesus Christ as my personal savior, you know. No, the salvation that Jesus offers us, we receive it not through just reading about it, not just talking about it, not just studying it, although those are important, I'm not saying that, but we don't go, you know, to a university, do we, and take salvation 101. No, we receive it when we experience it. And how do we experience it? You know, we're talking about heaven and earth here, by the way. We're talking about God's creation. God created the heavens and the earth. And in Genesis, what did God call it? He called it good. And why is it good? Because God is good. And all goodness and all of charity, every quality that lifts us up and causes us to feel and experience joy or peace is born out of the Spirit of God. Think about the conversation, if you get a chance, or go read it, between Jesus and Nicodemus, going back to John 3. You can find it right there when Jesus told Nicodemus, you must be born again. And Nicodemus replies, how can this be? Am I to enter my mother's womb again? Well, that would be an experience, wouldn't it? But Nicodemus didn't understand. He didn't get it. And you know what? Lots of times I don't get it either. But I can tell you this. The power of God encompasses all of existence. God is one. There's no place where the power of God stops and the power of anything else begins. It's important to remember that. And so Jesus explains to Nicodemus, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless they are born of water and the Spirit. And the water is what cleanses us. Baptism into a new covenant is an entering into a life of the Spirit. And by this we are made clean, so that we may live in the Spirit, where true life exists. And it's then that we come to know Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. We know our Redeemer lives. It's not just book knowledge. It's not just something that we talk about. It's an experience. And a sense of peace settles upon us, a peace that surpasses all understanding. When the world seems to be crumbling around us, we're able to remain centered in God's peace. We can be calm because we know. We just know. So often we look around this world and put so much faith in the physical. What we see and what we hear and taste and touch. When in truth, these are just shadows of God's true creation. It's true, God allows us to live in this fallen world where we uphold the sins of the world. But as Jesus reminded his disciples time and time again, do not store up earthly treasures where moth and rust corrupt. And yes, on one level, this storing up can mean wealth and possessions. But on a deeper level, this means our tendencies to put our faith in things of this world, relying on this physical world, where we believe that an income sustains us, or we believe that our heart keeps us alive. Well, it doesn't in reality. Does our heart keep us alive? No. You know, someday this very heart of mine will stop beating. Anytime soon? Frankly, I hope not. But when it does that mean I don't live anymore? No, because our lives, our true life, is in the Spirit. When we are born of the Spirit, we are truly living. We don't perish because we are walking by faith in the reliance of the sustaining power of God's Spirit, and not by sight, which are the things of this world. How much stock do we put in the power of God? How much do we really trust in the presence of God? If Deuteronomy 6 speaks the truth when it says, the Lord our God is one, then there can't be two powers. You know what it doesn't say? I can tell you that. The devil, it doesn't say the devil is also one. I can promise you it doesn't say that. As Connor McLeod of the Clan McLeod says in the movie Highlander, there can be only one. The enemy would love to be God, right? The enemy would love to have all the power and would like us to believe that it does have power, and we fall for that. And we fall for that a lot. Adam and Eve fell for it when they were tricked into believing that they could know what God knows, that there could be a power besides God. Welcome to the biggest scam in creation, the biggest scam, which has stood the test of time. And because we humans believe there could be any power outside of God, we freely give this false power out like candy on Halloween. We give doctors and nurses the power to heal as if they had that ability. We give the food we eat and the water we drink the power to sustain us. We give our employers, our investments, the bankers, the power to keep a roof over our heads and our heat and lights on. And we even give power to death itself, allowing the fear of it to control so much of our lives. But I say it again, there is only one power. Remember, and disclaimer here, I'm not saying those things aren't important. They are. If you're a doctor or a nurse, don't get mad at me, because believe me, I appreciate all you do. But could there really be power in death? We are a people obsessed with death. Jesus was crucified, yes, but that's not why we celebrate Easter. We revere Christ for what he did for us. We look at the absolute excruciating torture we put him through, and we marvel that he still loves us and did not condemn us. But if he died, and that was the end of the story, we wouldn't be celebrating too much, would we? There'd be nothing to celebrate. Yes, we mourn. Yes, we look within ourselves and we ask God to forgive our shortcomings on Good Friday, right? We metaphorically tear our clothes and put on sackcloth and fall face down in the dirt. But then, 3 days later, we look up and we see Christ has risen and we rejoice. We rejoice for life because that's all there truly is. Where is thy victory, O death? Where is thy sting? We rejoice not because a man has risen, but Christ, the embodiment of the Spirit of God in all of its fullness and glory, has proven that this world, this physical world of pain and disease and war and hunger, has no true power to keep us down because we know our Redeemer lives. Jesus the Christ, the Messiah, and all that he did, all that he taught, all that he told his disciples rose again to show us what he told Nicodemus that night. Stop trying to get back into the womb of this world. Stop trying to give power to the things of this world that have no power. That world is gone. My friends, when you leave here today, when you walk away from this service, go out into the world. Look around you. Ask yourself, where does the true power come from? Take notice of the Spirit at work. If you want to see how bad it is in this world, just watch the news. But let's take time to look beyond this world and ask God to open up our spiritual eyes that we can see, truly see, and ask for the wisdom to discern that there is renewal, and we are made new every morning in Christ if we would just let Christ go before us and be our provider. It's getting warm outside as the winter starts to turn to spring. We are reminded of this truth, right? God is making all things new. We are reborn into the Spirit, but we do need to trust. We do need to be still and get out of our own way. And we do need to take time to quiet our minds and our hearts and listen. Listen to what God has to say. Listen to God's voice. Remember Elijah in the cave heard a great and powerful wind that tore the mountains apart, but the Lord was not in the wind. After the wind, there was an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake, nor was he in the fire. But after the fire came a gentle whisper. The Lord is not in the fires or in the fighting or the wars or the division or in cancer or any disease. The Lord is in the whisper, reminding us that we do not live on bread alone, nor anything else of this world, but by every word, every whisper that proceeds from the mouth of God. And that is where all power will be found. Amen. Well, I just want to quickly remind everybody, those of you out there, disclaimer, don't get me wrong. Everything that, like doctor's nerves, whatever I answer, the point is, I hope that you caught the point. The point is that when it comes down to it, there's only one source of power and strength where all things proceed from, and that is from God. And that inspires us to go out and heal people. But we need to remember the true source of where that healing comes from. Anyway, I finished the sermon out. I'll stop right there. So why don't we go to the Lord in singing another hymn. I'll take hymn. but we'll sing the next song, which is, I'll have it. I'll show you. Here you go. Love divine, all love excelling. And if you're reading a hymnal, it's 384. Let's sing out to the Lord together.
Thank you.
Our second scripture reading today is going to be found in Psalm 46. God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. Therefore, we do not fear, though the earth give way and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea. Though its waters roar and foam and the mountains quake with their surging, there is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy place where the Most High dwells. God is within her. She will not fall. God will help her at break of day. Nations are in uproar. Kingdoms fall. He lifts his voice and the earth melts. The Lord God Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Come and see what the Lord has done, the desolations he has brought on the earth. He makes wars cease to the ends of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the shields with fire. He says, "Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. Well, since I got this screen up, let's go to the Gloria Patri. Sing it out this morning. The words will be on the screen. My dear friends, as we go into the time of prayer, let's quiet our hearts and our minds and let the Lord settle upon us his peace as we take a moment of silence, as we bring up in thought, perhaps somebody who needs prayer, any situations. There's so much to pray for, the fighting going on in the world and different natural disasters and people losing loved ones. And of course, you know, we just talked about this in the message. However, it's not easy. And so the Lord came to earth, saw our pain, and knows our pain. And so we are called to pray and lift up our thoughts and prayers to God. So let's do so. But first, let's bask in the allness and the healing wholeness of God for just a moment. Let's take a moment of peace. Well, gracious and loving God, we come before you this morning with the acknowledgement that there is nothing that we could pray for that would surprise you. You know our hearts. You know our needs even before we do. We do not know what we ought to pray for, but the Spirit itself intercedes for us through groanings too deep for words. Scripture tells us, and your knowing, Lord, an omniscient nature, Lord, help us to open our eyes to see the love that you have for each and every one of us. Give us the courage to let that love transform us. Renew us, Lord. We ask you, as we do our best to walk the way that you have laid out for us, help us when we struggle to love those around us. May we encounter the truth and the life that service brings as we serve and let ourselves be served as well and loved also. Please be with those who are struggling with losses, Lord, the loss of loved ones, the loss of property or employment. Lord, you are the fulfillment that is needed in all situations that find us in need. Lord, watch over our children, our schools, all who work there, our communities, so that we might not be so divided, but give grace freely as we have freely received grace. We pray for the continued blessing of our freedoms and for our country. We pray for our world as so much tension and fighting are occurring. Lord, help us to keep sight of your prophetic truths given through us, through Isaiah to us when he wrote, "They will beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks." Lord, nation will not take up sword against nation, nor will they train for war anymore. Lord, help us to find peace in those words. For it is in your precious name, Jesus, that we pray today with the prayer you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Again, I just want to send out a quick thank you for all those who give so much to our church, not only money, but time and prayers and everything that you, gifts. Thank you so much again for all that you've done. And I just appreciate it. We all do. And thank you for being such a faithful giver. So thank you again for that. So I just want to acknowledge that. Let's sing out our offering hymn. My friends, let's go to the Lord one more time in song. We'll sing out together. Our final hymn is Pass It On. It's number 572, and let's sing out. The words will be on the screen.
It only takes a spark to get a fire going, and soon all those around
Well, it has been such a joy to worship with you today, and I just pray for you that you have a most blessed week to come, that you are able to find blessings in as many things as possible, that you're able to bless others as often as possible, as we are called to do, to reach out and lend a helping hand as often as we can. But Lord, let's go to the, well, again, thank you for being here. Thank you for coming back next week, and we look forward to seeing you then. And if you want to do any donations, there's a link in the description below. But again, go out into the world, my friends, and just know that God, Christ, goes before you. That's where the true spirit lies. That's where true life is. Rejoice. Remember to rejoice. Aim for restoration. Comfort one another. Agree with one another. Live in peace. And the God of love and peace will be with you always and forever. Amen. Amen. God bless you all. Thanks again for being here to worship together. And I look forward to seeing you very soon, I hope. I love you all. See you soon. Take care now. Bye-bye.
Drop kick me, Jesus, through the goalposts of life. End over end, neither left nor to right. Straight through the heart of them righteous uprights. Drop kick me, Jesus, through the goalposts of life. Make me, oh, make me, Lord, more than I am. Make me a piece in your master game plan. Free from the earthly tempestion below. I've got the will, Lord, if you got the toe. Drop kick me, Jesus, through the goalposts of life. End over end, neither left nor to right. Straight through the heart of them righteous uprights. Drop kick me, Jesus, through the goalposts of life. Bring on the brothers who've gone on before, and all of the sisters who've knocked on your door, all the departed dear loved ones of mine, and stick them up front in the offensive line. Drop kick me, Jesus, through the goalposts of life. End over end, neither left nor to right. Straight through the heart of them righteous uprights. Drop kick me, Jesus, through the goalposts of life. Drop kick me, Jesus, through the goalposts of life. End over end, neither left nor to right. Straight through the heart of them righteous uprights. Drop kick me, Jesus, through the goalposts of life. Yeah, drop kick me, Jesus, through the goalposts of life. End over.